would be more like a personal account on how science, how responsible science should be, and how should we do responsible science, how should we act, how do we, should we be concerned about it, and how we can contribute towards making a culture of responsibility or a culture of biosafety and biosecurity in laboratories that we work in. So I would like to tell you about the two other positions that I'm currently having. One is I'm also a member of Equity Focused Coordinating Committee at International Federation of Biosafety Associations, that is IFBA. I will briefly tell you about what the aims of ECC are in a while. And I'm also serving as a Biosecurity Champions Fellow by Health Security Partners. Science, as we see, is, you know, it cannot be considered and or it cannot be thought of in isolation. The one of the major aims or the goals of science is to improve the quality of lives and improve the quality of people, quality of lives of people. So science has that social impact always. And we cannot, you know, do science without thinking about the consequences of science that it does. So whenever we are working in a laboratory, we should be very cautious of what we do, how we do, and how it is going to impact and affect the society and the people that we that are working around us, or the environment, or even our families. So this will be our topic of discussion today. Let me briefly tell you about how it all started. Like, my interest in biosafety and biosecurity started when I was working as, when I joined KIBG, that is Dr. Ek Chauhan Institute of Biotechnology and Genetic Engineering, as a research student. My aim was to work, to, you know, I wanted to study the genetic susceptibility of acute lymphoblastic leukemia in our local population. I wanted to know whether any genetic determinants are there that could cause susceptibility in our local population to this disease or not. So as a part of this research project, I had to collect blood samples and I had to extract nucleic acid from them. Although I used to do them routinely after my research project started, one day what happened that I was taking history from one of the patients, alongside taking blood sample from them. And that person who was admitted at Jinnah Postgraduate Medical Center, he told me that he currently had hepatitis B infection. That was the moment when I suddenly got worried that I will have to extract that sample, and this sample is hepatitis B positive. It was just a moment after that conversation ended, and I had some moments of reflection. I was like, even if any blood sample is not, any blood sample does not have a known infectious agent, it is still potentially infectious. So why am I getting worried now? Why wasn't I getting worried when I started working with blood samples? So that was actually the turning point, starting point, when I began to read about how blood samples should be treated, how they should be worked with, and are there any guidelines that are already present for working with blood samples or any human samples? And I started reading about those guidelines. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So that was the point when I started reading about how to work with blood samples safely and how not to expose yourself while working with human samples. And I was actually searching for the answers what we should do with I am going to extract nucleic acid from these blood samples, but we are discarding some part of the same potentially infectious sample. What is going to happen with the housekeeping staff? What is going to happen if I spill some part of that blood on the lab bench? how should I just decontaminate the lab bench then, so that my friends and my colleagues who are also working in the same lab, they do not get infected? What should I do so that I do not get infected by any of the pathogens that these samples may contain? From that point, I started learning more and more about working with that samples and what is biosafety and biosecurity. Although these were the topics that I had already studied about, but the practical realization is something that gets you intrigued, and you then you do not go back to the old version of you. So that was the realization that no, now that we are not sitting in a classroom, we are working with blood samples, we are working with human samples, so we have to be cognizant of the fact that they have to be processed very safely. And because I was very lucky that I was part of KIPG, which used to arrange and organize many different workshops and conferences. There were a couple of international conferences on responsible conduct of science under ICLS, and then there were different workshops that were co-organized by KIPG and Health Security Partners and Pakistan Biological Safety Association. And I was lucky that I became a part of them. So I was from that point, I got formally trained on biosafety and biosecurity aspects. Then there was this Frontline Foundation that was offering free online courses that were otherwise not free, but they were being offered free in Pakistan for capacity building of laboratory professionals in Pakistan. And as they are mentioned here, they included virus management and biohazardous waste management and how to use biosafety cabinets and dual use research of concern. These were four disciplines that these courses were being offered on. And as they were being offered, I instantly got enrolled in them and I started following them. The most interesting thing about these courses was that Pakistan Biological Safety Association had offered an opportunity that whoever completes these courses before so-and-so date, they will be eligible to be a part of a lucky draw. And the lucky draw will result in one or two professionals in getting a scholarship that they will be given a scholarship on IFBA certification. I'm sorry. Can everybody please mute themselves? Okay. So that was the point when, the point that I got intrigued that I have to complete this course before so and so date. I got them done, but still I was not, very hopeful, because to be honest, I have never participated in any kind of lottery or lucky draw or something, and I never considered myself such a lucky person ever. So I just completed the courses and I became eligible for being a part of that lucky draw. It was surprising to me that there were two professionals who were given the opportunity that they were given the scholarship of for the certification that of IFBA certification on biorisk management, and I was one of those lucky people. Let me tell you about something about the certification program. International Federation of Biosafety Association offers certifications on six different disciplines, but the biorisk management certification is their prerequisite. So this is usually the first certification that you do, and before you do, you complete this certification, you are not eligible for any other certification. So I was given the chance to, to get myself certified for biorisk management certification. And the interesting thing that happened, that although I was very happy, super glad that I had got this opportunity, this was a time when I was working and I was wrapping up my PhD thesis. So I was kind of double-minded that whether should I prioritize my thesis or I should prioritize my certification, because obviously the certification required me to study a lot. There were a lot of documents and standards that I had to go through before I actually attempted for that certification. And to be very honest, I had no time for it. So I prioritized my thesis, and although I was very, kind of heartbroken that I have this opportunity and I have become that lucky person who has got this opportunity and I'm just letting it go. But still I had to prioritize my thesis. So I was thinking that maybe I'll be able to submit my thesis and then go through all the documents that I have to prepare myself for before attempting for the certification, and then I will be able to attempt the certification. But things happen in a way that the last date that when I could attempt for this certification coincided with the date when I was supposed to get my thesis printed. So that was a very difficult decision for me to make, that whether I am going to leave it or attempt it. Anyways, I decided that I will give myself one single day and I will read as much as I could and prepare as much as better as well as I can, and then just attempt the certification, and it will be seen whether I am able to pass that certification or not. Anyway, so I gave myself a day, read everything that I could read in that day, and then attempted that certification, and I was done with it. The moment that I ended attempting the last question, they told me, I got the message that on the screen that your attempt has been recorded and your result will be shared with you soon. And I still remember the blank face that I came to the other room where my friends were sitting, and I told them that I have just attempted and they have not shown me the result. And suddenly there was a sound of joy and everybody was being very happy and celebrating it, that yay, you have got it. And I was like, why? Because I was so lost at that moment that I didn't realize that there was what used to happen was that if you do not get the required percentage, they used to let you know immediately that this is your result. But if you have qualified for the certification, for example, if their required percentage, the eligibility of passing percentage is 75%, if you have scored above 75%, then there used to be a scrutiny of how you attempted your certification, and then the result used to be revealed after a week or so. So that was the case with me, and my result was withheld because I had attempted the certification with the required percentage, and that was kind of like a kind of motivation factor for me at that moment. But still, it took me a while before I realized that this had happened, and within 2 to 3 days I came to know that I had got the certification done. This was mentioned that I was not in the phase, like I was not expecting myself to be done with it successfully. So it was kind of a very, very motivating factor at that moment. And probably I needed that push because I was at the point of submission of my thesis and submission of my thesis as well. So this appeared as a real push for me and a kind of a motivational factor for me. And this was the point where I got interested in biosafety and biosecurity and virus management so much that till date, I am doing biosafety and I'm talking about biosecurity as well. Then I got to know about a mentorship program that IFBA was offering, that was a global mentorship program. It was being offered in 2019 for the first time, and I attempted it. I applied for it, and I was again lucky that I was able to join the program as a global mentee. This program is a very, very beneficial program. It is a 1 year long mentorship program when the mentees are paired with a very experienced mentor in their region mostly. And then they are given different assignments and different reading assignments, also reading assignments and activities that they have to perform. They have to participate in various discussions. They have to, they are given discussion points, and they have to, you know, work on those discussion points along with their mentor. So in this mentorship program, I was paired with Mr. Furqan Kabir, who is the manager of research lab IDRL in Department of Pediatrics at Aga Khan University. I think a lot of people here would know Furqan, Mr. Furqan, and what a good trainer of biosafety and biosecurity and virus management he is. So I was again lucky that I got to be paired, I was paired with him, and I spent a very, you know, informative journey of that 1 year with Furqan. Then I joined Aga Khan University as a research specialist in October 2020. And it was under Fleming Fund project. And we were basically trying to build capacity of laboratory professionals who were working in specifically microbiological labs and biomedical laboratories. Our target audience included lab managers and different consultants, even the other laboratory staff, laboratory professionals. And what we aimed at was that we wanted to build their capacity on laboratory biosafety and biosecurity. So as you can see pictures, the first picture is that of our training on biorisk management and biorisk assessment in National Institute of Health. And the other pictures are from the trainings that we conducted at various provincial sentinel labs, including that of Jinnah Postgraduate Medical Center, Civil Hospital, National Medical, Mayo Hospital, Lahore, Sheikh Zayed Medical Complex, Hyatabad Medical Complex, and Khyber Teaching Hospital. It was a very worthwhile experience of training others and learning more and more about people. And I got to learn what are the basic problems that laboratory professionals face, and how difficult it is to be in a resource-limited setting and then think about biosafety and biosecurity, and how difficult it is for us being a citizen of Pakistan to prioritize our safety and our security, and then fight with organizations and defend yourself and your priority of safety so that you get resources to be able to work in a safe environment. Then this is something I was telling about initially as well, that there is a committee of International Federation of Biosafety Association that is known as ECC, Equity Focused Coordinating Committee. There are seven members around the world who are working for the cause of incorporating the principles of DEI, that is diversity, equity, and inclusion in global biosafety and biosecurity. So as you can see, I am the most, youngest professional among them. So it is kind of a learning experience for me, and I'm trying to learn and trying to take the benefit of this opportunity that they are very trained and they are very, well-experienced people around the globe. So I am learning a lot from their experiences as well. So as a part of ECC, we are trying to work for promotion of, gender equity and age equity, and how resources should be equally distributed, how DEI can be incorporated in terms of leadership, in terms of workforce, as well as in terms of resources. So if you want to, that is a very interesting project from International Federation of Biosafety Association, and I would really like if you go through the website of IFBA and you read about ECC, and there are a couple of projects that are being run by ECC, and one of them is Living Mosaic of Biosafety Professionals. Maybe some of you have gone through, have seen that video that we have recently produced, and they feature biosafety experts from around the world. There are 5 experts around the world which we have featured in that video, so as people to know. We want people to know that they are, you know, the biosafety heroes who are working for the promotion of biosafety and biosecurity in their region. So the difference between the basic difference between biosafety and biosecurity, I am sure you would know that biosafety is more people focused and biosecurity is more agent focused. So biosafety aims to protect individuals from the hazardous agent, and biosecurity aims to protect infectious agent or the biological agent from people who have ill intentions. Now, if you closely look at the first picture, there are 3 different things: people, red arrows, and the central globe that is being represented by microbiological agents or biological agents. Here, the colored part is people, and the color is representing the focus, and the arrows is representing the harm that is being, the direction of the harm that is being inflicted. So when we talk about biosafety, we talk about all the protection measures, all the mitigation controls, and everything that protects people from the harmful or hazardous effects of the infectious agent. And whenever we talk about the biosecurity, we talk about all the measures, all the things that aim to protect infectious agent from the people around them. So all the measures that that keep from happening the accidents and mishaps are regarded as biosafety. One are regarded under biosafety, and all those which are deal with deliberate threats or intentional exposure come under the umbrella of biosecurity. There were 2 studies, very comprehensive ones, which were published on laboratory acquired infections, because obviously when there is an exposure or to biological agent, there is a chance that infection can occur. And there are a lot of infections that have been reported by PI consultant in 1978. And as you can see that it was a report that featured around about 50, less than 50 years of infections. And there were more than 4,000 laboratory acquired infections that were reported, and 168 deaths were reported. And these infections included both the infections that were acquired from clinical or diagnostic labs, as well as the infections that were acquired from research labs. Similarly, another study was published 20 years later after this PI consultant study. And this study reported 1267 cases with 22 deaths. And this study also reported that infections occurred in clinical and diagnostic labs as well and research labs as well. As we are, as we all belong to different laboratories, whether in clinical, we are working in clinical laboratories or research laboratories, we should be thoughtful of it that we can acquire infection. Whenever we are dealing with biological agents, there is a chance that we can acquire infection from the biological agents that we are dealing with. There is one very famous case of Elizabeth Griffin, who was a 22 years old lady and who died falling exposure to a monkey's body fluids. She was working with rhesus monkeys who was infected with herpes B virus. And although she was very cautious that she was wearing, she always used to wear gloves when she used to handle the animal, and she was also wearing masks when she handled the animal. But because she was not using any eye protection, what happened was that when she was helping the animal to move, there was a very tiny droplet of a body fluid that struck in her eye, in her right eye actually. And following that exposure, she developed infection and she got paralyzed. And within 6 weeks of this exposure, she died. This happened in 1997 in Emory University, and she joined Emory University, a research group in that university. Then this was obviously the case of laboratory acquired infection that we just discussed, and it emphasizes the importance of biosafety and the safer practices and the importance of using appropriate personal protective equipment in laboratories when we are working with the agents or with the primates or anything. Then there is an interesting case that happened in 1984, which is a Rajneeshi attack. In this attack, what happened that Salmonella species were used, and they were inoculated in different salad bars, which were distributed at 10 different restaurants in Oregon. And the reason of why this was done was because they wanted to keep voters from voting in a local election. And as a consequence, more than 700 people got sickened. None of them died, obviously, but still the purpose was achieved because they wanted people to get sickened and do not participate in voting. So that purpose was achieved. This was the case of, you know, bioterrorism, what we call, say, or the biosecurity incident. Another attack that is known as anthrax attack is, you know, very common, very famous, and I'm sure you must have read about it or you must have listened about it. A couple of letters was distributed and they were sent to different senators and media personnel in USA, and they had spores. These letters had spores of Bacillus anthrax, and these letters, as a result of these letters, 22 people got affected. Some of them were able to recover, but 5 of them actually died. So this was again a case of, you know, how infectious agent can be stolen and can be misused and can be, you know, can be misused to achieve some ill intentions and something you want to, when you want to harm other people. So the point I'm trying to make after discussing these events is that any facility that is working with any biological agents must be able to know what risks are they dealing with and how they can effectively manage their biological risk. Now, whenever we mention the term of risk, whenever we talk about biosafety or biosecurity, these two terminologies, hazards and risks, are very important. And when we always repeatedly discuss them, let me go through them briefly. What is a hazard and what is a risk? A hazard is something that has the potential to harm you, that has the inherent potential. Yani ek khatarnak cheez, that would be called a hazard. It would be electricity would be a hazard, animal would be a hazard. In this picture, a shark is a hazard, right? And the risk is the likelihood of a hazard causing harm. So hazard is there. In these two pictures, you can see in both pictures, hazard is there, shark is there. But in the first picture, the person is standing at the seashore and the shark is in the water. So the risk of shark attempting or harming this person is low. And whereas in the other picture, when the person is swimming in the water and the shark is very present nearby him, here the risk of him getting harmed by the shark is high. This is the difference between hazard and risk, that hazard can remain same, but the risk can vary depending on the situation. I will re-emphasize the same concept that risk may vary while hazard remains same with another picture here. That in the first picture, you can see that a tiger is in the cage. And in the other picture, tiger is present out of the cage. So in the first picture, obviously the risk is low. And in the second picture, there is quite high chance that the tiger would be able to harm the person and the people that are present around this around the place where this tiger is present. Similarly, we can think about the biological agents. If you just think that biological agent is a hazard because it has the inherent potential to harm us. So hazard will remain same when we are working in a laboratory. Hazard will remain same. But the risk of us getting infected from that agent may vary. When we are working in a safe environment, for example, like this tiger is behind the bars, if our biological agent, if our infectious agent is confined within the biosafety cabinet, then our risk of getting infected is low. And if this biological agent is present out of the biosafety cabinet and we open the vial, and let's suppose we use any procedure that may aerosolize an infectious agent, our risk of getting that infection may get high. So keep this concept in mind, and we will talk further about the biological risk that we just talked about, may include biosafety risk as well and biosecurity risk as well. And they both add up to form biological risk. So whenever we talk about biological risk or bio risk, we are talking about both biosafe risks associated with biosafety and those risks associated with biosecurity. So whenever we are working in a laboratory with biological agents, whether we are working in a research laboratory or whether we are working in a diagnostic laboratory, we need to manage our risk that we are dealing with because if we are working with biological agents. And the process of risk management comprises of these four steps. First of all, we need to identify the hazard, and identification would be like which biological agent are we working with. Then the risk will be assessed. Risk will be assessed on the basis of characterization of hazard and the assessment of how much potential or likelihood is there that the agent will affect us. And this will include the characterization of hazard or the infectious agent, as well as the procedures that are used in laboratory protocols to collectively what safety equipments are present. To work with. Collectively, all these factors will be used to assess risk of biological agent. And then once you have assessed your risk, then the third step is that of mitigation and that of reduction of risk to be able to work with the same biological agent safely. And here is the concept that we just discussed, that hazard may remain same, but risk may vary. This mitigation will control how you will alter the risk, how you will reduce your risk while keeping the biological agent same. And once these steps are done, then the fourth step is risk communication, because you have effectively mitigated risk, but you have to communicate that risk or that reduced risk to others who are also working in your laboratory. So risk assessment is the basic thing, the most cornerstone, that central pillar, you can say, that over which all of the mitigation and management of risk is dependent. If risk is acceptable, you can proceed with the work. And if risk is not acceptable, you will have to immediately stop the work. And then you will have to add some mitigation measures to reduce that risk. But those mitigation measures could be like having standard microbiological practices, incorporating some safety equipments like biosafety cabinets or centrifuge cups, or maybe your protocols need to be revised, or your donning and doffing of PPEs should be revised, or you may need to, you know, strengthen your PPEs. Like you may need to add double masks or double gloves to effectively mitigate your risk of working with some biological agent. So the basic controls of biosafety are engineering controls, as I just mentioned, the safety cups and the biosafety cabinets. Engineering controls, what do they do? That they physically separate the infectious agent from the person who is working with the agent, like the behind the bar concept that we discussed in the example of Tiger. Engineering controls do that. Administrative controls are how things are implemented, how people work with those agents. They involve trainings and stuff like that, that how the laboratory professionals will work around that infectious agent. And then standard operating procedures are there. This is the third control of biosafety. Standard operating procedures are important because, you know, different kind of people are working in a laboratory. Now, these professionals, these laboratory personnel may have different emotional states. They may have different educational background. They may have different trainings. Now, so many different people are working with some protocol. How would they be able to produce a similar result? In that scenario, to ensure that they, even if they are different from each other in their knowledge, in their expertise, in their experience, and in their emotional states as well, we standardize some procedures that whether any of them go through that procedure, and if they follow the instructions as they are written, they will be able to produce similar results. This is the importance of standard operating procedures, why they are so much emphasized whenever we are working in a laboratory, that standard operating procedures should be there and should be, as they are present, they should be adopted. And then the fourth control of biosafety is personal protective equipment, which we all know that they include gloves, they include lab coat, they include masks. Personal protective equipment is one of the biosafety controls that has been very much emphasized after the advent of COVID-19. And we now, every single person, whether they are, you know, whether they are laboratory professionals or not, they have the idea what are masks and what are even N95 masks. They are very well aware of what these N95 masks are. So these are basic controls of biosafety that we use to mitigate our risk that we discussed in the third step here. After assessing risk, we use these controls and to mitigate and to reduce our risk of working with biological agents. Now, as I mentioned, that biorisk is not only dependent on biosafety, it also includes the aspect of biosecurity. So there are some controls of biosecurity as well. And the physical security, the physical control includes access control, like access to a lab and access to a biological agent should be restricted. They should not be, in access of every other person. Like if there is a laboratory and there is an inventory some infectious agent present somewhere in a laboratory, every other person should not be allowed to enter that laboratory. Then there is personnel biosecurity, that is another control, like people who have access to valuable biological materials, they should be competent enough, they should be reliable enough, they should be trustworthy, that they do not have any ill intentions. Because if they have, we know what consequences can occur. As I mentioned, the anthrax attacks, example of anthrax attacks and that of another Rajneesh attack. If material is available to any personnel, irrespective of what their intentions are, there is a chance that people may steal those samples or steal the material and may misuse it. then material security is very important. Whenever material is stored, there should be proper inventory of it. So if any vial is lost, if two vials are lost, somebody should come to know. Like, this is like, you know, it's quite difficult for us, but in our laboratories, mostly the situation is that even if we lose some 10 or 20 vials, it may take months for us to realize that something may have happened. And even then, we may think that these, we may have lost them somehow. We will not think about the biosecurity aspect usually. So this is one of the very important biosecurity controls, that whatever material that is valuable biological material that can be misused needs to be secured in a facility. And then there is information. Material alone is very hazardous, but if someone is not aware of what this material is capable of doing, he or she will not be able to exploit it, or he will not be able to abuse that material. But if information is also available and material, the valuable biological material is also available, then there is a greater chance that the information together with the material can be misused for any maybe personal gain or professional gain or for inducing harm on others. So these are four basic controls of biosecurity that we must practice and we must preach. Now, although we have talked about different controls of biosafety and biosecurity, and we understand that how they may mitigate our risk, but the bottom line is, adding an engineering control or getting your lab equipped with safety equipment is a thing, but actually reducing your risk, overall risk, requires people to practice biosafety and biosecurity principles and practices, and to, you know, it takes human behavior, and it takes human to actually act. So the plan, between plan to reach outcome, the deciding factor would be the behavior, how you and I will actually behave in the lab, that will determine whether we will be able to mitigate our risk, or we will be able to form a culture of responsibility, of a culture of safety, or a culture of biosecurity in our lab or not. So as per WHO definition of biosafety, you can see that there are three different dimensions. So we can say that biosafety is three-dimensional. There is a theoretical dimension that talks about the containment principles. And then there is a technical dimension, which focuses on technological advancements that includes safety equipment, facility design, how air is controlled, how it is decontaminated. And then there is behavioral dimension of biosafety. And this behavioral dimension decides and determines how you and I actually act in a lab when no one is watching. So these are a few good laboratory practices that we all are aware of. But although we all know and we all understand that it is not good and it is not allowed to eat or drink in a lab, but I'm sure that if not all, many of us will have the experience of eating something or drinking something in their respective labs. We all know that we should always wash our hands after removing gloves, but usually we do not do that. So there is a lot of difference between what we say we do, what we preach about biosafety, what we teach about responsible conduct, and what we actually do. So these are a few examples. Like, we know that people should not be wearing jewelry when they are wearing gloves, because the jewelry may result in, you know, eventually bringing holes in the PPEs. If there are any wounds in hands, you should be able to cover them before you start working with biological agents. If you are using a ballpoint or pen, it should not go into your mouth. And if you are really feeling very down, please do not go inside the laboratory and do not actively work. Because any day when you are feeling down and you are not willing to work, that day your performance will not be up to the mark, and you will be able, and you will expose yourself. You will have a greater risk of exposing yourself with biological agents you work with. So the most important element of containment is the word that is mostly used in biosafety and biosecurity, as mehdood karna, kyunki aap infectious agents ko confine karna chahte hain, you want to contain them so that they do not harm you as such. So the most important element of containment is strict adherence to standard microbiological practices and good laboratory practices. As much as you adhere to these practices, you will be able to contain your biological agent from harming you. Or otherwise, if you do not strictly adhere to these practices, you know what is going to happen. So the bottom line is that culture of biosafety and biosecurity is a culture of responsibility. And this responsibility is individual responsibility and a shared responsibility as well, because it is a shared responsibility that we all need to do the right thing. And doing the right thing is not usually easy. Doing the right thing is very difficult. It may take a lot of your time. It may take a lot of your efforts. But still, doing the right thing will get you establish a culture of responsibility in your lab. Otherwise, it will not be achieved. So it is said that a leader is someone who knows the way, who goes the way, and who shows the way. So any biosafety leader or anyone who wants to cultivate a culture of biosafety and biosecurity in their respective laboratories is someone who not only has the knowledge, is not only who himself does the right thing, but also who influences others to do the right thing as well. And let me tell you, it is not very easy. People will call you biosafety freak. People will call you a safety freak, that you are always talking nonsense, you know. But you have to be the person with, you know, with a better heart. You have to be tolerant of others, and you have to influence them in some positive way, so that this shared goal of developing or cultivating a culture of biosafety and biosecurity is achieved. Because culture is not something that can be done as a single person's effort. It takes many people. It takes, not even many people, it takes leadership of an institute. It takes management of an institute. It takes housekeeping staff of an institute. And it takes normal, usual researchers and laboratory professionals. It takes all of them to contribute towards safer practices, to strictly adhere to safer practices in order to cultivate that culture. So we have to be a champion of safety culture. And here I would like to invite you all to write a statement, a brief statement of how you can advocate to safe laboratory practices, and how you can advocate for safety culture in your respective lab. Do you have any idea that we have just discussed laboratory practices which are considered safer practices? And even other than these, you must be working in scientific societies and scientific laboratories in different regions. So you must be aware of what safe practices are. And do you think that you can contribute in any way towards promotion of safety culture in your laboratory? For this, I would like to thank you all. Thank you so much for your patience and your kind attention. And if you have any questions, please, you are warmly welcome.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alina, for sharing your personal experiences. And it was such a wonderful presentation. And the overall lecture you gave was amazing. So we have a message for you from Rimsha Zahir Ali Shah. She's saying that she liked the session and it was an interesting one. And I would like to ask the participants if they have any questions they can ask. Okay, so we have a question from Miss Amber Khan. She says, thank you, Miss Alvina, for such an informative talk. I would like to know your opinion about WHO's fourth LBM, which focuses more on good microbial practices instead of BSL and BSC. Which one is more important for a safety culture?
Thank you so much, Amber, for this question. There is a huge difference between Biosafety Manual, third edition, WHO's third edition of Biosafety Manual, and from the fourth one. And the fourth one emphasizes more and a lot more on safer practices and simple practices, day-to-day practices, as compared to emphasizing safety equipment, including biosafety equipment or others. Like we will not, even WHO has not disregarded the importance of safety equipment or engineering controls, but it has emphasized that even if you are working in a resource limited country, if you do not have the resources to develop a very such kind of facility that you would ideally have, you can still work with the infectious agents just by emphasizing your PPEs, your strengthening your practices, your laboratory practices. So this fourth edition of manual has, and I would agree to the approach, because we are also working in a resource limited country, so it is not entirely possible for us that we spend so many resources on establishing full-fledged ideal kind of facility to work with biological agents, but we can spend the same resources on cultivating a culture in our respective laboratories, and that is more relevant and more workable, doable, and more effective. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, we have a message from Dr. Afreen Aman. She says that it was wonderful to see you and listen to you, Alvina. Wishing you all the best for future.
Thank you so much, Dr. Afreen Aman.
Okay, I also have a question. During these times of COVID, you have seen that many health professionals were also affected by the COVID, and we have lost many of them due to this severe disease. So what do you think that where do we lack, or where are we standing today in terms of biosafety and biosecurity?
The thing is that many of the professionals do not have, I'm really sad to say that, but many of the professionals, especially our clinicians, our consultants, they are not, that much, they do not prioritize their safety. And safety should be our prioritization on personal level, on organizational level, and on national level. So the thing is that what we have in terms of COVID, what happened that we had a huge cause. And most of us would choose to work selflessly towards this cause, that we want to save our people, we want to serve our country. But the thing is that if we are not very well aware of how containment occurs, what we can contribute, how we can keep ourselves safe, then I can compromise on my safety if I'm not wearing masks. But it would not be a logical thing to do. If a physician is not provided or a respirator, full-fledged respirator, and he or she is, treating or seeing a number of COVID-19 patients, we ultimately know that what is going to happen with him. And I don't know if it is, it is a national responsibility that people, our physicians are our national assets. So they should be, their health should be our priority. If they are prioritizing national interest, that is saving people from a disease, we should be able to protect, we should be able to contribute towards their safety as well. So overall, there is a lack of awareness general lack of awareness. You just asked about the, you know, say healthcare professionals that lost their lives. Healthcare professionals are, I would say, they are not that much well aware of the biological risk that they are dealing with as much as laboratory professionals are. But laboratory professionals are also the professionals that they do not that much care about their safety. And they just want to work with that. We have so-and-so experience. Who are you to say something to us? And we would be able to, like, they feel pride in doing unsafe practices. So this is the kind of situation. There is a lot of room, and, you know, we need to educate. We need to build capacity of our healthcare professionals, of our laboratory professionals, and collectively overall situation of Pakistan. We know that even with masks, there were rumors and that they are infected with something, and if you wear a mask, you are going to get infected with such a disease. We know what happened in terms of COVID-19 in Pakistan. So awareness is something that we need to work a lot, still need to work a lot. Although PEPSA has contributed a lot in raising awareness, but still there is a room that we can do a lot in terms of capacity building of our professionals.
Thank you so much. I hope in future we create an environment in which we can say that we have a very safe environment, and we also produce some experts. We also have another message from Ms. Madiha Kaval, and she says, thank you for such a wonderful session, Dr. Veena.
Thank you so much, Madiha.
Another special message from Dr. Saima Saleem. She is also the head of SIN chapter of PEPSA, and she says, Alveena, I'm so happy to see you excelling in the field of biorisk management. All the best for future endeavors. Lots of kind blessings.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saima. You were also one of those that those biosafety professionals that I was inspired of, and I started learning from them. The first few that I learned from them.
We also have a very special message just specially for you. I hope you like this. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I'm fine. Nice to see you. And I really love to see you always. And I know that my brilliant, my beautiful, and my perfectionist. And even I can say, so I can associate so many things with Alveena. She's very hardworking. She is my first student, and she helps me in many things always, and I love to see, and I'm really happy to see you, Alveena, doing all this, and I really love to see you prospering in your life in such a way. I love it, and I wish you all the very best for your future, inshallah. You will shine, you are shining, and you will shine, inshallah. Nice to see you. And that was really a brilliant, informative, and wonderful lecture. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That means a lot. Thank you so much, Dr. Sifat.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alveena, for your time and for giving this wonderful and informative lecture. We hope to see you in future sessions as well. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much.
Now it is time for our second speaker, Ms. Dr. Fariha Ibrahim. She is currently serving as assistant professor at Ziauddin University. Over to you, Dr. Fariha.
Thank you, Arisha, for a nice introduction. First of all, I would like to say thanks to OWSD and KIPG for this lecture invitation. I feel honored to be a part of this lecture series, which is about the challenges for young women embarking career in science. Basically, today I want to share my PhD journey, and as the title suggests, the journey begins with the passion. And I believe everyone has something in their lives to live for. So I decided, or we can say, I describe the passion. In my opinion, the passion is something that someone is strongly desired for, or in another words, we can say the enthusiasm towards something. Alicia, can you please tell me, my camera is on?
Yes, we're here. Your camera is on.
Okay, thank you. So basically, I just want to summarize my story. From the beginning, I was interested in science and doing experiment, and I would love to work related to the science and experimentations and stuff like that. So if I can say, I wanted to become a doctor, but by the passage of time, I realized I couldn't be a doctor because I cannot even see someone in pain, and I cannot even see someone who is injured or their blood and stuff like that. So at that time, I started thinking something else. And when I talk to my family members, and few of my family members at that time, they were doing PhD and they were pursuing their higher degrees. So they suggested me to do master's and then PhD. So when I came in the university for the first day, I decided to get the highest degree. That is the PhD. And this is because I am here in front of you as Dr. Fariha. And obviously, for this journey, I faced a lot of challenges, failure, and sometimes demotivations. But this is all about the part of this journey. And if I talk about the self-reflections or the personal reflections, basically, personal reflections defines your ability to evaluate your own cognitive, emotional, and behavioral changes and processes. And in other words, we can say that the self-observation, which is very necessary throughout this journey, and you will definitely see a change in yourself after doing PhD or after doing any professional degree. Basically, this is a little bit about myself. I did my PhD from Dr. A.Q. Khan Institute of Biotechnology and Genetic Engineering, University of Karachi, and MS and BS in microbiology from Jinnah University for Women. Most of my area of research is microbiology and industrial biotechnology section. So the journey began from here. I started my postgraduate degree from Jinnah University for Women in 2012 and completed MS in 2015. This is the MS dissertation title, The Enumeration of Aflatoxigenic Aspergillus in Different Food Commodities and the Effect of Natural Extracts on Aspergillus Isolate. Basically, I did my MS research work at PCSAR Laboratory, Karachi. All of you, or most of you, know about the PCSAR Laboratory. They used to work on different food samples, and they used to test different food products and stuff like that. So my supervisor suggested me to do a literature review regarding the food commodities and the problem we are facing related to that particular food and feed commodities. So after literature review, I found that the fungi are the significant destroyers of food products and grains during storage, and basically, they're rendering them unfit for human consumption by retarding their nutritive value, and often by mycotoxin production. And among mycotoxin, the aflatoxins are the most intensively studied mycotoxin. And basically, aflatoxin are frequently occurring in different food and feed commodities. Research reported that the aflatoxin B1, B2, and G1, G2 are reported as the human carcinogens, and they are also listed as the toxic fungal metabolites. They are mutagens and immunosuppressive. So basically, I decided to work on aflatoxigenic species, and when I searched about that, so I found that the Aspergillus species, mostly Aspergillus species, are responsible for the production of aflatoxin in the food and feed commodities. So several studies reported the Aspergillus niger, Aspergillus parasiticus, and Aspergillus flavus are the most toxic species when we talk about the aflatoxin production. So I am just giving you a quick review of my MS research work. Okay, so basically, what I have done, I have worked on different food and feed commodities and samples which were available at PCSIR laboratories like maize, rice, cotton seed cake, and different spices samples. Then did microbiological testing, serial dilutions, and isolated Aspergillus species from that from those samples, and then did different analytical testing. We did PCR for the isolation of Aspergillus, isolation of aflatoxigenic producing Aspergillus aflatoxigenic genes, which are responsible for the production of aflatoxin in those samples. And then after identifying those particular genes, those strains were selected for TLC and then performed TLC for the detection of aflatoxin B1, B2, and G1, G2. And after doing these experimentation, we used different spices extract like cardamom, aniseed, and different clove, cinnamon, to test their antifungal activity. And the results were amazing. We found that those spices effectively inhibited the Aspergillus strain, as well as they displayed anti-aflatoxigenic activity in the liquid medium. So basically, this is all about my MS research work. One of the biggest hurdles that I faced during this research work is that the isolation of fungal species, because I used to work during my BS in different bacterial species, but unfortunately I did not do any work related to fungal species, their isolation and purification, like complete purification and identification. So I faced a lot of problems during this research work at that time, and one of the biggest drawback, or what can I say, like I lost my father during my MS research work, which is I cannot even explain my feeling right now. I was very close to my father, and at that time it was like horrible for me to continue my studies and all this, but I am very fortunate to have such friends, teachers, and my family member. They supported me at that horrible time, and due to their continuous motivation, and they motivated me, encouraged me, I recontinue my research work, and then I did two of the, I did my MS with two research publications. These publications, these papers basically were published after doing MS, and then I basically presented my research work for the very first time in the first International Conference on Life Sciences, Emerging Trends in Biological Sciences and Genomics. Basically, this organ, workshop was jointly organized by MAH Qadri Biological Research Center, University of Karachi, and Kibji. So this was the first time I came to Kibji, and I I really like the environment and the research facilities in the Kibji. So I did, alhamdulillah, successfully I completed my MS degree. After doing MS, I wanted to take a gap and wanted to do a job first and then continue my PhD. So my actually PhD journey started from here. I was appointed as a research assistant at Dr. A.Q. Khan Institute of Biotechnology and Genetic Engineering on a HEC funded NRPU project entitled Purification, Characterization and In Vitro Applications of Bacillus Bacteriosin, Active Against Multi-Drug Resistant Organisms Prevalent in the Community. Basically, after doing MS, when I was appointed as a research assistant, I was found this title very interesting and related to my field, because I definitely searched about before coming into the Kibji. I searched about the bacteriocins. Basically, these are natural antimicrobial peptides, and I really like the title. That's why I decided to work on this project. And basically, when I came to Kibji, then during project work, people used to suggest me to start your PhD from here. And then I decided to take admission in Kibji, started my PhD from here. And during project work, I found, and during literature review, I found lactic acid bacteriocins interesting as a food preservative. So as I was worked on different food and feed samples before, so I was interested in the food preservation, so I decided to work on that. So basically, my PhD research work was the production, characterization, and application of bacteriocin from indigenously isolated lactic acid bacteria. My research supervisor was Dr. Asma Ansari, assistant professor, Kibji. So basically, the reason I am adding this slide over here is that I just want to tell you the main problem which provokes me and my supervisor to do this research work. Basically, when I was doing the literature review, I was found that the food spoilage and foodborne pathogens are the major problem despite modern advances in technology. So I read several research articles related to my research work, and most of the article, it was found that there is a need to work on the stable LAB bacteriocin regarding to the preservation of food. Because the LAB is a GRAS, has a GRAS status that is the generally regarded as safe status. So it is the natural means of preservation which cannot be harmful for the consumers. And as we all know that the natural benefit of natural preservatives and natural traditional foods. So basically, the addition of chemical preservatives are becoming more toxic for the human consumption. That is why we decided to work on the bacteriocin. It is the alternative of chemical preservatives. It is safe for consumers and their consumption. Basically, the LAB bacteriocin display a crucial role in different disciplines, especially in the food preservation. And another main point to consider at that time, like the long-term use of chemical preservatives and physical treatments to control food spoilage of different food treatments have a serious side effects on human health. So basically, we wanted to isolate the more pH and thermal stable bacteriocin, which capable of inhibiting different foodborne pathogens. Along with that, they capable of inhibiting the multi-drug resistant pathogens as well. So keeping all these points in consideration, the study was designed to characterize a stable bacteriocin which will work under extreme conditions in different industries. Basically, the research outline was first, we isolated and screened different lactic acid bacteria, then identified those LAB strains on the basis of their bacteriocin production. And after identification, the strains were improved. Using combinatorial strategies, we did different we applied different approaches like optimization, statistical optimization, and mutation to enhance their potential to produce maximum amount of bacteriocin. And then after improvement, the bacteriocin was purified and characterized, and the name of that bacteriocin was the BAC-IB45. And after complete purification and characterization, the mode of action was determined. And moreover, we extended our study to towards cytotoxic analysis as well. This is the additional part we did in our study, just to evaluate our the efficiency of our bacteriocin. In vitro cytotoxic studies were performed, and then the application of BAC-IB45 was determined as a biopreservative. So basically, this is basically the research outline, and we have designed this. We designed this research outline at that time. When we designed this, then I was thinking like, this picture described my complete situation. Like, it was like my plan is, I was thinking at that time that we have, obviously we have so many facilities at that time. We can do like isolation, screening and purification and stuff like that. But the reality is totally opposite, and as seen in the picture, this is exactly the reality is. Like, when we start working on LAB bacteriocin, then we, how can I explain, like during isolation and screening of the bacteriocin producing strain, it took me around 6 to 7 months for the isolation of this strain. Basically, I have divided my study. I divided my study in four different phases. So basically, in phase one, the isolation, screening, and identification of LAB strain, then improvement. In phase three, purification and characterization, mode of action, and in the phase four, in vitro cytotoxicity and application were determined. So basically, during my first phase, I faced a lot of trouble at that time during isolation and screening. And then when we started improvement of LAB strain, or working on the improvement of this strain, we did statistical optimization for the first time, which is very at that time, which is very hard for me, but that is very effective for our strain. And they did like wonder, they have given us a wonderful results. So we did a lot of research work at that time during improvement and optimization and different approaches like mutation to get the better and better results. But if we talk about the purification, So this is like, this was the hardest or toughest part of my research work. I would definitely say that basically bacteriocells are low molecular weight proteins, and low molecular weight proteins are very much difficult to purify. So we did a lot of struggle during purification and characterization. And then this picture definitely, I add this picture over here just to describe my situation. These are the phases which I have been through. Like in the first phase, when we were isolating this strain, we were literally dying, like due to the contamination, due to the cross contamination, we faced a lot of problem, but we did a lot, and we struggled a lot for to overcoming all these issues. And then after some time, when we isolated our particular strain, identified or purified bacteriocin, then we the results were progressing day by day, and the research obviously were accelerating. So basically, finally, when we purified our bacteriocins, this was the wonderful day of my life. I can say, like, the SDS page results and the purification took a lot of time. And finally, when I purification was done, like, and my results were really amazing. So then after purification, in vitro cytotoxicity was performed, and then we did biopreservation in the meat sample. And in vitro cytotoxicity was also a challenging task for us, because at that time we were establishing our cell culture lab in our wing, and I was very thankful to my supervisor, Dr. Asman Sari and Dr. Sheen Aman, and obviously Director General Kibji, Dr. Abid Azhar, who always supported us throughout this journey, and who always available for us, like, to provide everything, whatever we want to, like, in the way we want to do whatever the new things in our to evaluate our research and to make innovations in our research. They are always available for us and always guided us and motivated us to do all the right things at the right time, and at the, we can say, the limited time. So after doing all of these experimentation, I faced a lot of challenges, and many of us from my junior students and from my senior students, they all used to face these challenges, like isolation and stress, basically anxiety, family pressure, self-doubts, funding issues, lack of resources. And one of the biggest problem is or challenge we faced, like, for publications. So basically, when we talk about the isolation, one of the most common problem for PhD student is the feeling of isolation, because PhD candidate often work alone, and having few or sometimes no other people around them, which leads to the loneliness and the lack of motivation sometime. And the PhD student can be extremely stressful, I must say. And it has been found that the PhD student have high level of mental disorders. For this reason, basically it is imperative to find a healthy ways to decompose, decompress yourself, whether through your healthy activities, whatever you like artistic work and whatever the things you like, you should implement during these PhD journey and during these hard times. Do meditations as well, do exercises and anything else, whatever you want to do. Because regardless of thinking like how bad you are feeling, but it is always helpful to talk it through with someone or do something, whatever you like to do. Because another problem is basically the family pressure. And another challenge for a PhD student and for me as well, with a lack of personal support, friend, like family members, and sometimes they may not understand the worth of the PhD and may not support it. Many of us or many of the PhD students or the students who are doing their professional degrees has been distressed by the well-meaning relative, like asking continuously about when they will be finished with their PhD and get a real job and stuff like that. So these all are very challenging and obviously ultimately they're stressful as well. And there is one thing is the self-doubt as well. Basically, when you do something someone from your surrounding demotivates you or discourages you continuously, then you feel self-doubt, like you don't feel like doing anything. And whenever you do something, you feel like doubting your results and stuff like that. And these are very demotivating for a PhD student, because when you do something for your career and for your willingness, so someone in your surrounding definitely be there to support you, to motivate you. And this is in this regard, the supervisor play an important role in the life of a PhD student, I would definitely say. And I am very fortunate to have such supervisors and mentors in my life at that hard time. There is another issues like funding issues and the lack of resources, but they will be resolved by the passage of time. And another one is the biggest challenge is the publication. So basically, I'll talk about the publication later. Basically, I was very fortunate to take admission in KIPG and to be a part of KIPG, because they used to they have a practice to continuously arranging different presentations, different seminars, different oral and poster presentation competitions. So basically, during my research work, I have presented a poster presentation, also participated as a presenter and as an organizer, which helped me a lot to organizing things in the 5th ICLS KIPG conference on responsible conduct of science, ethical concern in medical and pharmaceutical practice and research, which is organized by Dr. A.Q. Khan, Institute of Biotechnology and Genetic Engineering, University of Karachi. I have attended, or I used to, when I was in KIPG, I used to attend different conferences. I used to participate in different conferences, seminars. A few of them are listed. Like I have also participated in oral presentation 14th Biennial Conference on Molecular Biosciences Research and Innovations, organized by Pakistan Society for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, PSBMB. Another, basically, when you felt like doing nothing and stressed about something, then these seminars and these conferences world like wonder, and definitely you met different new peoples, new friends, and these are really helpful during throughout the PhD journey. Then when I was working on purification at that time, then I my supervisor and my mentor Dr. Sheena Mann motivated me to apply on this Asian Federation of Biotechnology conference. Basically, I presented my some part of my research work over there. I went to Kuching, Sarawak, Malaysia with Dr. Sheena Mann and my another friend. And basically, it is all about the International Symposium, Role of Biotechnology in Sustainable Growth and Development, organized by Asian Federation of Biotechnology Malaysia chapter, including University Putra Malaysia and University Technology Malaysia at Kuching, Sarawak. I have been awarded, and basically it is an honor for me. I was awarded as the Young Scientist Award at that time, and this basically motivated me a lot. Basically, when I was at that point, I was doing like purification and SDS page and stuff like that, and that was very demotivating me. The results were not satisfactory. So at that time, this basically gave me a spark to do something different, and basically this kind of activities motivated us. And then during my PhD, I have published 4 of my research articles. Among them, 3 are impact factor journals. So basically, I want to share my publication experience, and I definitely guide my junior fellows. Basically, when the results are not satisfactory, like we are not getting much results, and at that time we don't waste that time, and we utilize that time to writing a research articles, to writing your thesis, because I believe in that. Like my teacher used to say that, but at that time I definitely couldn't realize the worth of publications. But right now I must say, you can publish as much paper as you can at the time of your PhD journey. Basically, after doing PhD, you will definitely get job and involved in those job activities and different stuffs at that job position. So you don't get time for your previous publications and previous record to collect data and do from the beginning. These are very what can I say, hectic during or with the job basically. So if you want to publish your research work in reputed journals and in good impact factor journals, then you have to work on the publications first and during the research journey. So I have published 4 of my research papers at that time, and these are basically the beautiful memories, because I cannot say like the PhD journey is very challenging and hard for me, like, but I had made so many beautiful memories with so many beautiful people around there. Like I had made so many friends, different teachers who always supported for me, who always care about me and guided me. So these are some of the pictures I have gathered on one slide. So finally, after collecting all these precious memories with myself, I have submitted my thesis, and this is the day of submission. I submitted my thesis in 2019 December, and I cannot explain my feeling. This is the time my all hard work pays off. So, and due to COVID-19, I submitted my thesis in 2019 December, but unfortunately due to COVID situations, my viva was delayed, and this is the day of my viva. And finally, I have successfully defended my thesis and my research experiments. And after successful viva examination, I can say, or I can define my personal reflections, like, research has taught me to be patient and has developed many skills. Like, this is the slide I really want to share with you all, because when you start your PhD, or when you start any professional degree, you are not very much confident and like expert in your skills areas. But after doing PhD and after doing research, basically research has taught me and everyone to be patient, and has developed so many skills, like presentation skills, analytical skills, like problem solving, time management. Basically, they increase your confidence, boost your confidence, new ways of thinking, enhance knowledge and skills, and obviously new friends, and transformation of myself, I can say. This is a complete transformation of myself, or one's self, like, what can I say? Basically, one of the most important thing is the time management, because we have so much to do, so little time to do it. So the time management is very important, and we learn time management from our research journey. And basically, we used to organize our calendars and organized our appointments. These are the things we used to learn from our research journey and from our PhD journey, what can I say, like professional journeys. And obviously, when we talk about the new friends and transformation of myself, basically when I think about myself as 3 or 4 years before, so I when we used to talk about like presentations and confidence level, then this was, I was nothing at that time. But after doing PhD and after doing my professional degree, I realized myself, I basically evaluate myself, and I evaluate myself according to these points, and that is why I really wanted to share these points with you. I hope most of you will definitely realize after doing PhD the changes in your life and in your lifestyle, in your way of thinking as well. So basically, I really want to share this picture over here. The iceberg illusion, what people see and what people don't see. Like, the people see is the success of someone, like the tip of the iceberg. But what people do not see, usually your efforts, your dedication towards your PhD or towards your goals, your hard work, your disciplines, sometimes or many times the disappointments, the sacrifices you did, the failure, and the most important thing, the persistence. So this picture basically appropriately defined a PhD journey of anyone. So basically, these are the things with what people do not see usually, and the people see is only the success, that they go through the achievement of the success. They do not see usually, but they see the main success, what you are doing right now, but what you did before, no one knows, and only your close fellows and your supervisors, and those are the people that definitely know about your dedication, your hard work and stuff like that. Basically, this is all about my PhD journey, and after finishing or after completing the PhD journey, I must say I now understand that doing a PhD is all about having a passion for learning and figuring out something, being determined, consistent and focused, and talking taking care of good things and oneself during your entire PhD journey. What I want to say right now, one has to have a stubborn, resistant and refusal to accept defeats. One has to believe that however good or bad time or bad situation is, it will change over the time. So overall, getting a PhD is a challenging experience for me, both personally and academically. So despite all these ups and downs of PhD, I embrace the challenge and to get out of my comfort zone to transform myself and create a better version of me. So this is all about my PhD journey. Right now in Ziauddin University, these are my responsibilities. I am working as an in-charge biotechnology program, as a head invigilator, focal person of Directorate of Educational Development. These are the courses I am currently studying, food biotechnology and medical cell and tissue culture, microbial biotechnology. One of the project I have submitted to HEC is it is a collaborative work basically with the Dr. Asif, who is associate professor at Ziauddin University in electrical engineering department. I'm very fortunate. One of my research paper recently have published. Basically, I have published five research papers from my whole PhD work. This is basically the last research publication from my PhD. And overall, my PhD experience was very challenging but motivated, and the people around me were very skillful and always encouraged me and motivated me towards my journey towards PhD. And this is all about me. I am very thankful to HEC. Recently I got the HEC approved supervisor letter, and these are my number of publications right now. And this is all about my journey. I am very thankful to all of those who are listening to me. And this is me, and this is me after doing PhD. This is Dr. Me. This is all about the journey, and this is all about the problems, the consequences I faced during this journey. I faced a lot of hard time as well, but I am very lucky to have such friends and family members and peoples around me to motivated me throughout my hard time and make it possible to get my PhD degree. Thank you so much, all of you, for listening to me.
Thank you, Dr. Kaya. It was such a wonderful presentation, and you have shared your experiences in a very detailed and well-mannered. So we have some messages for you. First message is from Dr. Saima Saleem, and she says that so glad to call you Dr. Fariha, as I have seen your hard work and courage to face the difficulties of PhD journey. So proud of you. All the best for more success and achievements in the future.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saima. And thank you so much for always supporting me throughout my PhD journey.
We have another message from Sarva Sahai. She says that your journey is very motivational, and thank you for your informative presentation. And we have another message from Dr. Hajra Naz. She says that it was lovely to see the slides that you have used to depict the difficulties that you have encountered.
Thank you so much, all of you, for listening to me, and thank you so much for being a part of this lecture series.
And now we have a message from Dr. Sayyida Nuzat Nawab. She says that great efforts, Dr. Fariha, and she also have questions. Her first question is, what is your experience regarding the research environment at your current university? And do you have any funded projects over there, or how do you people manage the financial burden of research work in your current university? And her other question is that, what are your plans for your postdoctoral study?
Thank you, Dr. Nusrat. Nice questions. First, I want to answer your first question. Basically, in Ziauddin University, we are launching our MPhil PhD programs in biotechnology. Currently, we are just working in the graduate programs like BS level. So basically, we are launching, and Alhamdulillah, we have approved our MPhil program, and by the end of this month, we will definitely get approval for the PhD program as well. So I'll be supervising MPhil PhD students later in upcoming semester. So I cannot say anything about the research environment from Ziauddin University, because the biotechnology department of Ziauddin University is not a very old department. Basically, it is establishing. It is an establishing process, what I want to say. And another question is the HSE funded project. Basically, in Ziauddin University, we are working in research. Here is a research lab, Dr. Asif, basically, who is the associate professor over here in the electrical engineering department, working a research lab. They basically design a project for HSE in TTSF project, in NRPU project, and they offered different faculty members to involve in those projects according to their expertise. So basically, the project which I have assigned is basically related to the pesticides and the biotechnological aspects as well, along with the artificial intelligence and machine learning. So in that project, I'll be the part of that project, inshallah, if the project would get approval from the HEC. So basically, this is the scenario of Ziauddin University right now.
Okay, and what are your plans for your postdoctoral study?
I am planning, but not right now. Basically, as I told you before, from the beginning, I really wanted to do a job first. So basically, after MS, I didn't get the chance to do a professional job or to experiencing job, what can I say? So first I want to do a job for a few years, and then get experienced myself, and then apply it for definitely postdoc.
All the best. Now we have another question and appreciative messages from Dr. Tayyiba Asif. She says that it was always a pleasure to hear from your side. Lots of love and best of luck. And her question is that, how you motivate yourself for research publication even after the rejection, as it is a mandatory part of research?
Basically, as I mentioned before, the publication is basically ultimately you are recognized by your publication. As I am working in the university, and I realized that the people used to ask about your impact factor, your cumulative impact factor, your publication. So basically, that is why the reason I am presenting my journey over to you guys, like I want to motivate you all at that time when you are working in laboratory and when you demotivate sometime, then don't waste your time at that time. This is the best time to make research publication, to make more and more impact factor publications. So you will definitely get reward after it. So basically, I always, and not at that time when I was a student, so I was not like motivated myself, but my supervisor, Dr. Asma Ansari, I am very thankful to her, and Dr. Afshin Aman, they used to motivate us for research publications, because they used to tell us that you are nothing, you are recognized by your publications, your stuff like that. So that is why they always encourages us, and they used to say, like, they used to motivate us for publishing a paper in good impact factor journal. So basically, these are what I believe, these are their efforts at that time. As I am a teacher right now, so I used to say my students, like, I effort for them, like they are like they are the students, so they behave like a student, and they are obviously the graduate student, so they behave like they don't care anything about that. But I used to motivate them, do final year projects and do research and do experiments, do wet lab. So being a teacher, I am very thankful to my teachers as well. They always motivated me for publication, and because of her, I did alhamdulillah 5 publications from my research work.
That's amazing. Now we have Dr. Sairish Fatma. Ma'am, can you please unmute your mic?
Assalamu alaikum everyone. Am I audible, Arisha?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. It's so good to see Dr. Fariha Ibrahim, and we always cherish our students. Fariha, it was a very nice presentation. I have some very basic questions. As you are currently working in Zaudeen University, so what are the challenges, or you can say, the limitations that you are facing right now, as it is a budding department?
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sairish, for your question. Basically, as I told you, we are basically leading like graduate level, because it is establishing day by day, this department. So we have an approval of MPhil, and by the end of this month, we will get the approval for a PhD as well. So as a PhD student, or as the professionalist, basically, we used to establish our lab first, because being a biotechnologist or microbiologist, I know that our student definitely suffered a lot when we don't have enough resources in the laboratory, and we don't have those equipments and stuff like that. So I am working on that right now, to be very honest. We basically talked about the financial issues and the things that we need in our lab, like incubators and stuff like that, which will definitely require after enrolling MPhil and PhD students. So we are working on that basically, and our HOD basically very helpful for us. Basically, he is from biomedical engineering department, but they those departments used to help us in this regard. So basically, what can I say right now, we are just in our renovation stage, we can say. So things will be getting better day by day.
Yeah, all the best for your future. And I have one very basic question, and that question is regarding your BS research program, or you can say the topic that you have done. It was something about some antifungal activity. Like long back ago, when I was small, I used to see that my mother never used to keep the natural spices in fridges because they never get spoiled at room temperature in our kitchens. But nowadays, what I usually observe is that the natural spices, if they are kept at room temperature, like for more than 2 months, they get something, they get spoiled or something like that. So in order to preserve them for longer period, we have to keep them in refrigerators. So what is the reason behind that?
Okay, one of the basic reason to spoilage of those, basically these natural spices work as antimicrobial agents, and our I think grandparents used to place clove in the rice jar to prevent from fungal contamination and to prevent from contaminations. So, but right now, one of the factors is the environment and the humidity. The environment is fluctuating day by day, as we all are suffering from this. So maybe one of the reason is the humidity and the environmental contamination. So that is why we all used to preserve our spices and red chili powder and sometime composite samples, biryani masala and stuff like that used to kept in the fridge because of the contamination they spoiled in the room temperature and our kitchens. I think one factor what I understand is the humidity and the environmental factors.
All right. Okay, the last question. The last question is that which natural spice has the most antifungal activity?
Okay, this is a very nice question, and I was really amazed after doing experimentation. Like the cumin has a maximum antifungal activity other than rest of the spices, like we used cinnamon and clove and as well and any seed as well. And then after cumin, the best results was obtained from the cinnamon. These two spices have the best antifungal activity. It was observed at that time.
Thank you, Dr. Fariha. We have a message from Dr. Afshin Aman. She says that it is always great to see you, Dr. Fariha. Many, many best wishes for your future endeavors.
Thank you, Dr. Sheen. This is all because of your efforts, your continuous dedication, motivation towards us. Thank you, Dr. Sheen.
And we have another special message for you as well.
Thank you, Ms. Arisha. Thank you, Fariha. Very good afternoon, everyone, as it is now not morning. And I want to say thank you to OWSD Pakistan National Chapter for giving this opportunity to our enthusiastic researchers. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Ibrahim and Dr. Zahra for their success and achievements in their life. And it is very wonderful to see you people, that you people are doing great and doing working a lot in your respective sectors. And Dr. Ibrahim is my first PhD student, and it is really a very, very different feeling to see your student at a certain level, or you can say that in a productive mode. And in my opinion, this is the reflection of your institute, or it is a training from your institute, or you can say that it is the responsibility of your leaders to produce a leader, effective and efficient leader, just like Dr. Fariha and Dr. Zahra. They both are our true shiny stars, and I'm really very happy to see you people there at this forum. And as a supervisor, I want to say one word for Dr. Fariha Ibrahim, that she's a very hard worker and she has an urge to learn something new. And I also learned many things from her. Thank you, Dr. Fariha. Thank you, Dr. Alina Zahira. And good luck, both of you, for your future. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Asma. We are here basically just because of you. You always motivated us and encouraged us to do a lot of new works and to take a lot of new challenges at that particular time. So I definitely say I am here just because of your continuous efforts, your dedication towards my PhD work. Thank you so much.
Now I would like to request the Secretary of OWSD Pakistan, Dr. Saima Saleem, for the formal vote of thanks. And before moving further, last time, thank you, Dr. Fariha, for your detailed and wonderful sharing of experiences.
Thank you, Irisha.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone, and a good afternoon for all the members who have attended this session. This is my pleasant duty being a secretary of OWSD National Chapter for Pakistan to thank all of you, especially Dr. Zahra and Dr. Ibrahim, that she has given us a very brief but a very interesting journey of their PhDs and how they are excelling in their life ahead, and we are really very grateful for that. In fact, this vote of thanks message is coming from our president, Professor Veena Siddiqui. She was connected, but somehow her internet is not working, and she is really very happy to have you all at the end of this year that we are achieving OWSD National Chapter activities and all the women power empowering their journey as well as their PhD studies, and they are looking forward for all the work they have learned from here and they are implementing in their job environment. So good luck for your professional journey. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everyone. With this, we have come to the end of the session. Thank you all for joining us in today's session. And we are looking forward to all of you to join us in our upcoming sessions as well. I hope you all had good time with this. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.